Okay, every once in a while I get asked to speak about climate change and planning. And then, because things are happening so fast, it gets a bit depressing, you know, once you get the updated figures and stuff. And just want to note that whatever we are doing now, I think climate change has to be front and foremost, even in terms of all the sustainable development goals we have to set up there. The change is happening so fast, and many of us don't realize it until we actually research it in detail. I work for ARUP. We are a very social and inclusive company. We are 100% employee owned, and we have a breadth of multidisciplinary disciplines out there in the company. Some of the projects we've done, you see like Marina Bay Sands, CCTV buildings, the bird sands, etc. If we are not convinced after what Xiaoyan has mentioned earlier, I think we should be actually pretty afraid. The hottest 5 years on record was the last 5 years we had. The hottest and warmest 20 years we have on record was within the last 22 years. So the effects are right there for us to see, and this consistent trend can't be all that much clearer. Mendenhall Glacier, Alaska, 58. This is usually, the photos are usually taken in the middle of summer. You can see the difference in 58 and in 2011. The difference, and glacial ice is very different from snow. It gets compressed over centuries. It doesn't usually melt that much. Hence, you get a slight blue tinge when you look at glacial ice. I was there last week, and this is only the start of summer. Quite a bit of difference between even 2011 and what we have now. It so happens, when I did the research for this project, where we were last week is already the least amount of sea ice we have in the Arctic Basin. So 2019, this is already the least amount of sea ice we have ever in human recorded history. And it's only the start of summer. This is the Arctic. We always talk about the Northwest Passage. You get all the great explorers like Evensen and all of them trying to cross from the Atlantic to the Pacific. Ice is usually so much that you usually can't go across. But over the last few years, it's become easier and easier to cross the passage because there's so little ice left. You see the ground going up and down. It's, you know, in winter it goes up, in summer the ice becomes less. But the trend is that it's becoming a lot less over the Arctic. What happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic. Because you get the jet streams moving, and because the Arctic is warming up, the jet streams are slowing down, so you get the meandering patterns. And in between those patterns, the heat builds up, or you get intense storm where you get a lot of hurricanes, you get a lot of snowfall. This happened in California. So when the jet stream comes through, you get these pockets where heat builds up. Hence, record amount of bushfires in California. This happened in 2017. The Mendocino Complex fire, the largest wildfire in history. 1,300 square kilometers were burned. Anyone knows what day this is? It's a polar bear. So what happens is the polar bear, because it's getting warmer, it moves further down south, it mates with the grizzly bear, and you get the polar bear. So this is happening more often. So it affects biodiversity as well when climate changes. We looked at, when I first started talking about sustainability and stuff, we were looking at 375 parts per million. Xiaoyan's number was 403 parts per million, and that was a few years ago. The number today is 415. So when you look at all the projections, even the lowest projection from IPCC record is way beyond that. And the highest is unimaginable. So what does this number mean? If you get to 500 parts per million, the temperature of the Earth is expected to go up by 3 degrees. So if you get to about, so this is all history, it's never seen. If you say we're going to level off in terms of the amount of carbon dioxide, how promising do you think it's going to be? It's happening now, it's not going to happen in the future when our kids are even around. So when you get to 500 parts per million, the anticipated temperature rise is going to be 3 degrees. And what is the difference between, well, the Paris Agreement talks about 1.5 to 2 degrees. The difference when it gets to those numbers, let's say for example, ocean acidification, if it gets to 2 degrees warming, there will be no coral reefs in the world. 1.5%, 70 to 90% of coral reefs will be gone. Because ocean acidifies, calcium can't concentrate in shellfish and corals, hence it doesn't form. So we have to drastically slash emission by 45% from the 2010 levels by 2030, and we have to hit net zero by 2050, and that's just to hit 1.5% difference in temperature rise. What do we see in the future? Is it going to be green buildings like what we see here? Wuhan does a lot of nice weeds, I mean plants on buildings. How much is that going to make a difference? Are we going to make cities float? Because the water is definitely rising, it's just a matter of how much. Is it too far-fetched? Not really. I mean, the ancient guys have done it in Peru. There's the Ikaka in Peru, in Cambodia, Kampong Law. It's all adapting to the difference in temperature. I think what's most important, especially for us in the built environment, is that we built frameworks that can address this. We helped the 100 resilient cities develop the city resilience framework. So what essentially you have on the outer frame is making sure that all those different categories and objectives are met, from leadership and strategy to health and well-being, the economy, etc. And then you built it into KPIs, and then you have actionable items that help you to hit those targets you've set. So you go through the entire process from objective setting and then into actionable items that meets your overall objective in the past. We've done it in quite a number of cities as part of the City Resilience Framework. We're working with the C40 cities. The C40, if you're not aware of it, if you Google it, it connects more than about 90 of the world's greatest cities, and then we help them track and strategize on actions which helps them to meet the climate targets. We've done quite a number of reports. Every couple of years we'll do a report with C40 just to track what cities are doing in terms of addressing climate change. RENBO has also worked on developing climate resilient frameworks for the C40 group of cities. We've also looked at, in terms of digital technology and citizen engagement, in terms of how citizens work around and help the cities in acting on climate change. We've identified a few actions with regards to C40. The main issues they have is usually, as we usually do, access to capital, helping them develop a narrative to address climate change, making sure everyone's on board, working with the private sector, helping city governance be more reactive in addressing this, and then the vertical integration between the governance as well as how it applies into the private sector as well. 1.5% is critical in terms of addressing this issue. Main area we have to focus on is consumption-based emission, because in actual fact, it's a lot more than production-based emission. It's about 60% more. And in many cases, for example, food, how we travel, production, some of the patterns around consumption, what we buy, is easily actionable. So we are able to control about 60% of that from city development. So we have to drastically reduce urban consumption by 50% by 2030 and 80% by 2050 from just consumption-based emissions alone. So for example, there are six focus categories, including what things we purchase. Food is a big one. Just by cutting beef consumption, emissions reduce quite significantly. Travel, mobility, for example. We're also working with the Asian Climate Change Resilience Network. A lot of this focus around adaptation in terms of flood management, water management, for example. I'll quickly show you some examples we've done in China because I was based there for 10 years. Why China and India is important is because they're still not quite up there in terms of GDP per capita, but the volume and by the sheer number of population they have, the volume of carbon emission potentially is huge. China, urbanization by this year is 59%, was only 24% in 85. There's going to be 1 million people in urban centers by 2025, 221 cities with more than 1 million population. So when you look at carbon emission by sector, a lot of it is you target the low-hanging fruits, which is power production and manufacturing. They're doing very well in terms of where they're getting up to renewable energies. The targets they've set is actually going to hit it a lot more than the targets they've actually set. So whether in terms of automotive and mobility, EV vehicles, public transportation, and all, they're doing extremely well. I'll just show you a couple of examples in terms of actionable items from a planning perspective where we are able to make a difference. Granted, it's not enough at the moment because the targets we set then is not as high as where it should be. It shouldn't even be net zero, it should be climate positive, the targets we should be setting. But what we're able to influence is, for example, when there's a typical zoning plan, like most places around the world, usually they just tell you about plot ratio, how dense it's going to be, how much open space you're going to have. What we're able to change in China is that they're able to put carbon targets directly into the zoning plans. So any developers that come in and want to build there have to hit those targets before they're allowed to build. So this is a project that was completed, won quite a few awards. We did the Shanghai Post Expo. We did it as a pilot study with the Shanghai government, looking at building infrastructure, transportation, energy supply, and then the last thing you look at is carbon offset in terms of emission. That's a lot of technology that went into there. Those are some of the targets we managed to hit. A lot of technologies in the 18 different buildings there. And that's the completed part of the Shanghai Expo site. We do a lot of zero carbon buildings. It's not enough. Zero carbon is not enough. We have to go beyond that. It has to be climate positive. So maybe to take out more carbon and have more energy going into the grid and what they actually use within the buildings itself. This is the CIC building, zero carbon building in Hong Kong. And this is the completed one. So in essence, I think we have to make sure that innovation and delivery is all throughout, from the client to the contractor to the construction managers to the occupiers, and a lot of it starts from us as designers. I'm getting a note to complete as fast as I can. Even if you're doing LEED Platinum, it's not enough. So even if all our buildings, let's say in China, is LEED Platinum, that's not enough because we are starting from such a low base. Even if we are going LEED Platinum, the total amount of carbon being emitted is still much more than what's current. So our standards have to go much, much higher. We've done this over the last 20 years. We are constantly pushing the boundary. We try to set even higher targets. It's not as easy as it sounds because obviously economics come into play. We They're working with the Economic Development Board, looking at the Future Cities Hub. So climate change is an aspect of it. In conclusion, there's a few areas we should focus on. We have to go beyond business as usual. Our zero carbon targets are not enough based on our respective service offerings. We have to target the lowest hanging and biggest amount of carbon emission first, so that we are more resilient to climate change across all scales, from the city strategies down to buildings, etc. We have to target it across all scales. And then there's a lot of challenges around, but there's a lot of commercial opportunities as well. This is a photo from a few days ago. I think you guys might have seen this on Facebook. What should have been ice is water out there, a layer of water, when they're using the huskies to go through the ice in Greenland. On that day, Greenland lost the equivalent of 2 billion tons of ice. 22 degrees Celsius above normal. 22 degrees. Because what happens in a global average? We might not feel it as much here. 1 degree difference in Singapore, it impacts the Arctic 2 or 3 times more. So every change in temperature in the Arctic is multiples of 2 or 3 times. We are really the first generation where we are feeling the collective impact of humanity. What would we want the future to be? The younger ones might not know this movie. Waterworld. But I think for us all here in this room, our circle of friends, especially our friends in the built environment, I think it's still, the future is still a story for us to craft. And we have to challenge the many preconceived notion of what normal is. So we are all the co-authors of this future story, and we have to believe that we can make a difference. And hopefully it's a story worth walking into in the future.